Saturday, 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. Sunday. No Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, no Thursday, Friday again. And start at 7 p.m. sharp. We hope that you can all make it. And make a note of the Zoom number. Make a note of it. Write it down. Take one of the flyers. It's different from a regular Malton Zoom. Just for the series. So if you can't write it down or take a picture of it, just grab one of the flyers and it's on it. So if you're going to be watching it from home, you need to use that Zoom number. All right? It's something most people didn't realize. They just see Zoom and think it's a regular Malton Zoom. So be aware of that, okay? Our first annual fellowship dinner. It's coming up on the 26th of April, this month, between 3 and 7 p.m. It's, you know, maybe I should read what I have here. I'm wearing glasses too, you know, so I'm blaming my wife for it. I can't see. Yes, between April 28th, 1923, it says 7 p.m. here, but that's what it is. Okay, and to pay, it's a date. It's a date. You're going to take your spouse out. It's a date. It's a semi-formal thing. We're going to have a wonderful dinner. We're going to have entertainment. It's a date. So if you haven't taken your spouse out in a while, buy two tickets. It's cheaper when you buy two. And take them out that day for dinner and entertainment. And it's right here in our gym. It's going to be looking nice. If you were here when we did our 40th anniversary, it's going to be something similar, how it's decorated. So make that a date. And to pay, you can send your money to the Malton Treasurer, and Malton Treasurer at AdventistOntario.org. And in the note part, just put banquet tickets. Or you can see Brother Kennedy. You can get the tickets directly from Brother Kennedy. And I think Sister Wilson also have tickets, and other people, but Brother Kennedy is the main person to get tickets from. So don't forget that date. It's the 26th. Sister Kennedy? April 28th, 2024, between 3 and 7 p.m. That's the date. So don't listen to what I said before. Okay, then. Next slide there. Please save your unwanted. Well, I shouldn't even put unwanted. Please save your slightly used or new items for the Malton 7-day yard sale. This is not just any yard sale, because this is specifically for ADRA. And we're planning to have it. The time and the space we're going to have it at is not yet known. So it's either going to be here or somewhere in the community. But we want you to take the stuff that you still like, that you maybe grow out of. We don't want your junk. Please. So I want to take out this word unwanted. So please save your wanted, slight to use, or new items to donate to the Malton SDA yard sale for the ADRA drive. And it's, we're always ahead of most people when it comes to the ADRA. We contribute a lot, we do a lot, and we're going to continue with that. So coming up for our camp meeting, vocalists are wanted for the camp meeting mass choir. I think this is our 125th anniversary, and it's going to be special. You know, the conference want to have a mass baptism. And they also want people to be on this mass choir. So all you singers looking at me, I want you to, the information is up there. It's for the conference. Vocalists wanted for camp meeting mass choir. And it says, for inquiries, please contact your choir director, Pastor Carl Cunningham, at Cunningham at AdventistOntario.org. So it's from the conference. So all you people want to be a part of this mass choir, please contact Pastor Cunningham. Okay? And our Zoom prayer meeting, prayers continue. every morning from 6 a.m. to 7 a.m., except Sabbaths. You know, it's wonderful. If you've never been a part of it, it's wonderful. A lot of times I'm there, I'm just listening. And even when I'm half asleep, I'm listening. But I turn it on because I'm inspired by the people who come there every morning. You know, it's a commitment that they make. And this is when they pray for you and your family, or the people you ask them to pray for. So make it something that you check out every now and again. And also on Tuesday mornings between 7 a.m. and 7:20, the men's ministry. That's the other thing now. It's for the men this time. You know, just stay on after the regular prayer time. And for 20 minutes, we have our little session. And that's also wonderful. It's just men, so we can talk about women, among other things. Continuing on Wednesdays at 7:30 p.m., our regular prayer meeting. So it's something that I encourage you to participate in, because this is when, you know, it's we take it to God in prayers, and it's very important. That's how we talk to God, and that's when we sit down and we have individual prayers. We have people praying for, interceding on behalf of other people. So make it an effort to tune in every Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. Okay, I think that's it for today. And the rest of the reminders, just a reminder, send your bulletin information in by Wednesday, or any information for AV by Wednesday, because they need to get it ready. So that's it for today for announcements. And Brother Supriya would like to say something.
Good morning, God bless church. Happy Sabbath. Yes, just a couple reminders. It's right after we're having a prayer and fast, right after Divine. They're going into a prayer and fast session. And also, not 3 o'clock, but 5 o'clock, the pastor will be breaking a message in the revival. And after that, a Vesper. I do believe those are the only change in what you were doing there, Elder. Also, the social club is in full effect. Yes, we will be having, I pray the weather is good, May 19th, a picnic out at the Paul Coffee Park. Everybody knows where that is? May 19th. So bring a friend, bring your barbecues, bring your games, and bring your smiles. It's going to be needed so that we can go out as a church family and just have a good day. Starting from 10 till whenever. We have the park booked all day. After that, boy, we're getting really into this camp meeting stuff, eh? Camp Frienda on June 7th, 9th weekend, our church will be going for a church camp. I will have a sign-up sheet just to get an idea on how many people are interested to come. June 9th, 7th to 9th, the 7th to the 9th weekend, all right? So we would like to know how many people are coming, so that way we could budget properly and making sure everybody is comfortable. Is that okay? Social club is starting to happen. God bless.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. It's good to see you all in the house of the Lord today. It's a blessing. And welcome to those who are also online. Please stand for a call to worship. Our call to worship is taken from 2 Peter 1, verse 5 to 11. 2 Peter 1, verse 5 to 11. And I will read. But also, for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly in the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is our call to worship.
Tess, join us as we sing "Welcome Into This Place."
Saints, would you please kneel with me? Almighty God, you who dwell on high, but yet you never forget us, your children down here, we bow before you this morning with grateful hearts that we've got the gift of another Sabbath day. Thank you, Lord, that you woke us all up in our right minds. Thank you that we know where we are. Thank you that we know who we are and best. Thank you that we know whose we are. We praise and magnify your holy name for all your goodness towards us, for keeping us through 6 days of work and toil, and for gathering us here where we can praise and magnify you. Oh, what a mighty God you are. No wonder angels bow before you and adore you, because you're a good and a great God. We bow before you, Lord, just thanking you that Sister McCurvin was able to get through her surgery successfully, and she was able to praise you after it. We thank you for that. We bring before you this morning the others of our church that are ill. Lord, they are your children, and you shed your blood for them. So this morning, I ask you that you'll just touch them wherever they are and whatever the situation is, and let them know that you're the best physician ever and they're to turn to you. So we lift them up before you. We lift up our young ones before you, Lord. We lift up the adults. We lift up the seniors. And we know you're a covering God. So we lift your people at every age up to you today, asking you to take care of them. Lord, we're lifting up to our speaker before you this morning, Pastor Swaby, This is your manservant whom you have used over and over. So I pray that your arms of love will be stretched around him this morning as he mediate between you and us. And may we be blessed for his delivery this morning. I pray, Father God, that you'll help us to remember that you're the God that is here with us in whatever circumstance we're in, whatever crucibles we're going through. And so, Lord, I pause for a moment now to let your people privately tell you what is on their hearts. Lord, I ask you to forgive us of our sins and our shortcomings. It is our desire every day to be closer drawn to you, but we slip so often. So I just ask you now, Father God, that you'll keep us under the shadow of your wings and hold us up. And when the devil tries to pull us down, Lord, please slip in between and lift us up and help us to remember that you are the only one that died for us, no one else. And if you could go to Calvary for us, there is no limit to your love for us. Lord, I'm so grateful now that I'm using the medium of prayer because I realize this is the only medium that can move mountains. So any obstacles that's in our way and preventing us from being drawn close to you, oh Lord, be merciful unto us today. I pray, Lord, to remember your congregations everywhere throughout earth's remotest bound, wherever they are calling on your name, be there to bless and do them good. Lord, I put before you the group of people who have gathered here to acknowledge you. Bless them, I pray, Lord. Bless them. Bless their going out and their coming in. Bless everything that they do and help them to remember who died for them and that you're God and you're the same God yesterday, today, and you will be their God tomorrow. And I thank you for that. I pray that this Sabbath day, Lord, it will be such a blessing to us that when we have finished, we will realize surely the Lord was in this place. Surely he was here and we didn't know it. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for the rest of this day, the rest of the Sabbath day, where we can pause and forget about everything that's weighing us down. Oh, Lord, thank you for this repose. So as we go through this revival this weekend, revive our souls. Help us not to be selfish, to keep it for ourselves, but to let others know who you are. And as we prepare for our series, may our hearts be so prepared that others will see you in us and be led to glorify you also. We praise you over and over again. And lead us, O God, to live lives that will draw others closer to you today and always. And Father God, when you burst through the azure skies, may the saints in this building and in other congregations this morning be able to look up and realize that you're coming for us. So may we prepare now so on that great day we'll be able to meet you and hail you as our God and Savior. I pray and praise you now in your almighty name, and our people say, amen.
For all the little one. And I do believe a video was prepared for you all. So I would ask all the little ones to come to the front and quietly be seated so you can watch this wonderful video.
Hi everyone, it's Aunt Fernita. Today's story is called Messenger on a Mission. The memory verse is from John chapter 20, verse 21. It says, "As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." Today's message is I serve God when I willingly help others. Have you ever been to an airport? How about a boat harbor? Was it fun to watch all the planes and ships coming and going? In today's story, Paul is in a boat harbor. What is he doing there? Perhaps it was like this. Sailors with heavy bundles on their shoulders tramped down the gangplank to the docks at the seaport of Troas. Paul pushed his way through the jostling crowd, asking where the ship was from. Perhaps he stopped one of the sailors. "Have you come from Macedonia?" he may have asked. When he found out that the newly arrived ship was from Macedonia, he scanned each face for that of his friend Titus. Titus was the kind of person who made many friends. He had a way that drew people to him. If there were disagreements between church members, Titus could help. He helped them see where their differences were and helped them resolve them. He was just the kind of person Paul needed right now. Paul had written a letter to the people of Corinth about changing their ways. The church members there were new Christians. They had never worshiped God before. Many of them were former idol worshippers and criminals, and Paul had written that they couldn't slip back into those old habits and witness for God at the same time. So Paul had sent the letter, but he had no idea how the Corinthians had responded. He was worried that he may have offended them. He cared so much for them. He wanted to visit them if they would let him. And that's why he had sent Titus to Corinth to see if his friendship was ruined. Had Titus managed to help them see that Paul's criticism was based on love and concern? But Titus wasn't on the ship from Macedonia. Deeply concerned, Paul decided that he would go to Macedonia himself and find Titus. He had to know how the Corinthians had responded to his letter. In Macedonia, Paul found Titus and asked about his Corinthian friends. Were they willing to see him again? Or had he permanently ruined their friendship? "They long to see you again," Titus said joyfully. "Our new Christian friends were concerned about your worry over them, and they definitely want to see you again." Relieved at last, Paul made plans to visit Corinth. He wrote a personal letter to his friends there. Titus would take it to them. You can read that letter in the Bible. It's called 2 Corinthians. In it, Paul tells the Corinthians that he is glad they are still friends. He tells them of his love and care for them. He encourages them to cheerfully give a generous contribution to an offering that many churches were collecting for the poor in Jerusalem. Paul wrote that he hoped the church would show love to Titus and to those traveling with him. Titus served not only Paul, but also the people in the churches. Perhaps you have the same gift of getting along with the people that Titus had. Titus willingly and joyfully served others. He and Paul really cared about the people who had joined God's church. That is why Paul wrote letters to help them stay true to Jesus. That is why Paul, Titus, and others visited them. Titus and Paul cared about those who were outside the church too. That is the reason they kept traveling, to share the good news of Jesus' love and to help meet people's needs. Can you let others know you genuinely care about them, as Paul and Titus did? Will you serve them joyfully and willingly?
This podcast is read by Franita Buddy for Grace.
Hey, that was a wonderful story. So little ones, please make your way back to your seats quietly. Thank you. At this time, we will have a special music by Paul Cunningham.
Good morning, church family. The song that I'm about to minister to you, it says here, "He is my everything." And as we continue on this Christian journey, I would pray that we will continue to make God our everything. Because when we look around the world, nothing really matters. But if Christ is in our life, he's everything to us.
His possession, he is my everything. I remember my days of darkness, without sunshine or sign to lead the way. Then a whisper of his voice softly called me to the arms of my Savior to stay. He is my reason for living. Oh, he is the King of all kings. I long to be his possession. He is my everything. After the lightning and thunder, after the last bell has rung, I want to bow down before him and hear him say, "Well done." He is my reason for living. Oh, he is the King of all kings. I long to be his possession. He is my everything. I long to be his possession. He is my everything.
This time I'd like to call the deacon. Deaconesses forward, please. Today our offering will be going to the local church budget. What is the local church budget? Local church budget is our church, Malton SDA specifically. It allows us to continue to have service here, have the lights on, have the heat going while it's cool outside, have the AC running when it's hot outside, and all the other little things that go on, the quarterlies and offering everything. that we do here at Malton is facilitated through our local budget. So we do ask that when you do put on your tithe envelope for your offering today, don't just leave it blank. Specifically mark it for the local church budget, your offering up on the local church budget. That way, the money that stays here will be able to continue to bless us as a church and our community. So let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the Sabbath. And we thank you for the gifts that you continue to give us. We ask now, as we return what you have loaned us, Lord, we ask that our little will be much and that you will bless it abundantly. We thank you. We love you. We praise you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Please stand for scripture reading. Yeah, the scripture is Joel 2, from verses 28 to 32. And here is the reading. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. All your sons, all your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servant and upon the handmaid in those days will I pour out my spirit. And I will show wonders in the heaven and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall come on the name of the Lord shall be delivered, for in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance. And the Lord had said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. Here ended the reading of the Lord's word. Please be seated.
It is now time to introduce the speaker of the hour, but before I do so, I would like to introduce a very special person who's in the house worshiping with us today. Sister Josephine's husband, Mr. Asaro. Welcome. Welcome, sir. We've heard a lot of good things about you, so it's finally good to see your face. God bless you, and may God continue to be with you as you spend your time here with your family. Also, welcome to your family, whom I did not see before, the ones I did not see before. Also, welcome. We're happy you're here worshiping with us today. Give them a hand. He was on quite a journey. Please give them a hand. Blessings, sir. Okay, you may be seated. Our speaker of the hour is none other than Dr. Daviceto Swaby. And I believe his wife is also here. Can you give a wave, Sister Swaby? God bless you, and we're thrilled that you're here worshiping with us today. Dr. Swaby is the lead pastor of the Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church. And his message today is entitled, I Will Go. I'm looking forward to this. But before he speaks, we will hear another song of meditation by Mr. Paul Cunningham.
You know, as we travel through this world, we have faced many trials. And sometimes we get discouraged, but we just got to hold on. The song says too much to gain, to lose. When we think of what we're going through and to give up when we're almost home, wouldn't make sense, would it? Too much to gain, to lose. Many miles behind me, too many trials are through, too many tears help me to remember there is too much to gain, to lose. Too many sunsets lie behind the mountain. Too many rivers my feet have walked through. Too many are waiting over yonder. There is too much to gain, to lose. I've crossed this hot, burning desert, struggling the right road to choose. Somewhere up ahead, there's cool, clear water, and defeat is one word I don't use. Too many sunsets lie behind the mountain. Too many rivers my feet have walked through.
Too many treasures are waiting over yonder. There is too much to gain, to lose. Too many treasures are waiting over yonder. There is too much to gain, to lose.
Thank you very much, Brother Cunningham, for allowing the Lord to use you to minister to us today. And special thanks to Elder Cowan for his introduction. And of course, your pastor for sending out the call to come and share the word with you today. As you know, I am just up the road from here, just 3 minutes from my church to your church. 3 minutes. So it's just up the road from here. If I were to put one of those speaker horns on the top of the church at Perth and preach, you should be able to hear here. It's so close. And so I'm here. I said to my first teller this morning at church that I am the associate pastor here. I was here last year too, if you remember. So obviously I'm the associate pastor. So I'm willing to fill in as long as I can make it happen, where church is together working for the same cause, and where we can assist, we will indeed assist. I want to commend you for your upcoming evangelistic series, When Years End, Ours Begin. Ours begin on the 27th, same day when years end. And seeing that I have come to yours in your preparation, I don't need to say anything else, right? I don't need to say anything else. But it's always good to be at Malton. For those who came in the church after 2009, you might be seeing me for the first or the second time, but for those who were here in 2009, you would have seen me over and over. I was here for 3 weeks in an evangelistic series. Pastor King was the pastor here at the time. So if you just trying to connect the time, he was the pastor at the time here. And I stayed with my lovely host and mother and father, the Kennedys. They took care of me. I felt happy. I felt comfortable. I was treated like a son. And so I give God thanks for that. So it's good to be back with you. I want to share a word with you titled or captioned, I Will Go. I Will Go. And I wasn't given an end in time, but I know that there is prayer and fasting, so you have nowhere going, right? You're going to be praying afterwards, so you can pray. During the sermon, you can pray. All right. Let us bow our heads together for prayer. Our Lord and our Father, we thank you so much for the wonderful opportunity we have to share the word. We're happy, Lord, that the pastor of this church, my colleague and my friend, has sent this invitation. Lord, as I preach the word today, may we all be blessed in Jesus' name. I Will Go is not just the topic for today's presentation. It is also the plan of the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists since 2020 through 2025. They are working with this theme, I will go. And this theme is created for the purpose of every member being able to make a commitment, not to man, but to God. Is each member saying, I will go? It's all about total member involvement, TMI. Total member involvement. I will go. Turn your Bibles with me, please, to first to John. That's the Gospel of John. John chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. John chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. Turn your Bibles, please. If you have your phones, you can, as long as you're allowed, you can look it up on the phone too. It says, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. This man came for a witness and to bear witness of the light that all through him might believe. There was a man, says the text, sent from God, whose name was John. This was not John the Apostle. This is John the Baptist. There is something special about John the Baptist. He was God's man, called for a great work, to be God's messenger, to bring to men the light of God. He was to make ready a people prepared for the Lord's first advent. In preparing the way for Christ's first advent, John became a representative of those who in the last days are to prepare a people for the second coming of Jesus Christ. In essence, we ought to be little Johns. Even if you're a female, each person is to be like John. One who is knowledgeable about this God to share this God. And I'm going to be breaking that down for you in simply saying, being knowledgeable about God doesn't mean having a theological training. It means having a relationship about this God. And that should make a difference. Signs everywhere are saying to us that the Lord's coming is even at the door. Just yesterday we heard of the earthquake in New Jersey and New York and in a few other places that were affected. 4.8 earthquake. In Taiwan a few days ago, a day before that, it was 5.1. Mexico, the day before that, as the same day of Taiwan, there was an earthquake there too. Not much was said about it in the Western media, but there had an earthquake there too, a 5.0. Then, of course, there across Iran, they had an earthquake too, 4.4. Puerto Rico, and all of this is a day ago. 1.1 or 3.1 in Puerto Rico. Argentina, 4.1. Chile, 3.1. And I can list you, there are at least 25 earthquakes that occurred on Thursday. Sometimes because we don't hear it, we think it's not happening. But the media seeks to tell you what the media wants to tell you. But I'm simply citing those to say to you, the coming of the Lord is near. There have been unusual floodings in places that shouldn't be flooding. Even California. Serious floodings where lives are lost and properties are all gone. There is disasters in the skies. We all have heard about the Boeing, of course, airplane saga, where airlines are afraid to use these airplanes built by Boeing, and Boeing is one of the top rated companies, but there are problems in the skies. Various kinds of mishaps. There is wars and rumors of wars. We know about Ukraine and Russia. It's over 2 years now. There is Israel. And there is Palestine. In fact, I was supposed to have gone to Israel in November of last year. And I remember the Sabbath when I got to church, Sabbath of the 7th of October, someone said, "Pastor, you may have to put off your trip." I didn't know what had happened at the time. And then they said it to me, and by the time I got home and saw the news, I realized it's problems. Later that week, when I made on the Monday when I made contact with the company that I was going with, because I was taking 46 other persons with me. I was leading a tour. It was to have been my third tour there. And I had to reach out to everybody by email to say we are waiting on further information. The short of it is, the trip is off. Off for last year and off for this year too. There is no possibility of it being on for this year. The war continues, and there are multiple wars in different countries. It's a serious time. But God's people here at Malton are being called upon to tell individuals that the Lord is coming soon. John the Baptist was passionate. He was unique. He was odd. They saw him as a very odd character. How he carried himself, how he dressed, how he preached, how he baptized. They thought he was a crazy man, but it's okay to be crazy for Jesus Christ. John was not educated in the schools of his day, but John was taught by the Holy Spirit. Sometimes we make excuses as to why we can't be involved. We tell ourselves, "I am not worthy. I'm not qualified. I am not able." But I want you to understand today that John the Baptist was not schooled in the system of the day. But John knew what God said that he was to do. And with boldness and clarity of spirit, John went out and preached day after day the coming of Jesus and repentance of sin. We need to preach too. We need to preach too. But we need to understand that if God used John the Baptist, he can use us too. What do you say? John knew that he was a messenger of God. And without reservation, he raised his hand and said, when someone was needed, he said, "I will go." Who are we today? Are we messengers of Christ, or are we just Seventh-day Adventists? Are we messengers of Christ, or are we just individuals who our names are on the church's record? Who are we really? In the book of Malachi, chapter 3 and verse 1, it says, "Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. I will send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts." We need to understand that if we can't do anything for Christ, we should be able to be a messenger of Christ. You see, a messenger simply does what he's told to do. You simply carry out the instructions as they are given to you. You are given a message to carry, to share, to deliver. That's it. So it's not about how much you know. It's how much you understand the message. And the message doesn't have to be complicated. The message can be simple. In fact, the simpler the message, the more effective the message. Sometimes we complicate the message in trying to show how bright we are. And we use fancy terms and jargons. And we complicate the situation and we lose the soul. We look good in our own eyes. We look good and we feel good that we spoke up well. But we lost the soul for Christ's kingdom. Instead of making it plain and saying the thus saith the Lord, we tried to be a philosopher and a theologian to show how educated we are. There was a time when individuals felt that you can only be baptized if you could interpret the 2,300 days prophecy. And so persons would spend weeks and weeks and weeks trying to grapple with that. And they grapple with that. And they still don't understand the role Jesus Christ is playing in their lives. Sometimes we put the cart before the horse. And we are not as effective as we ought to be. John knew that all he was asked to do was preach the simple message. It was so simple that some thought they shouldn't accept it. It was so direct that some thought they should not accept it. They wanted to hear something different. He was responsible for directing his hearers to the greater light, Jesus Christ, the light of the world. He preached repentance and transformation. If there is ever a message that the church ought to preach today, it is repentance and transformation. And every child of God ought to see the need to repent on a daily basis. Every child of God must be honest to God, even if you are being dishonest to others. You must be honest to God. Sometimes we think that because we don't have the titles that others have, then we can't be of service. John did not get any credentials to preach, any authorization from the church to preach. The church never sent him out. If the church had sent him out, then they could have shut him up. But they could not, because he was sent by God. May I suggest that God is willing to send us out today. God is willing to use us and send us out to proclaim the truth of the everlasting gospel. Oh, a Sabbath school lesson for this quarter is about the great controversy, or controversy, depending on where you're from. But this gospel, this conflict between righteousness and unrighteousness, between good and evil, between God and the devil, will always be until Jesus comes. But God expects that those of us who are called by the name of Jesus will understand that our mission is to let others know that this controversy, as difficult as it might appear to be, will eventually come to an end when Jesus makes his appearing. So we must preach and let individuals know that the Lord is coming soon. John 10:41 says, then many came to him and said, John performed no sign, but all the things that John spoke about, all the things that John spoke about this man were true. John performed no sign. No sign. Didn't heal anybody from any sicknesses. All John did was to let people know that they need to repent of their sins and change their lives. He was not a healer. He didn't heal anyone. Sometimes we are, as we look at individuals that we think are important, we look at spectacular things. And we look at, has he ever healed anyone? It's like the Catholic Church will tell you that for you to become a saint, you would have had to done something extraordinary. And so when they look at persons that they want to class or of designate as saints, they look at miracles that they performed. John wouldn't have been in that, because John didn't perform any miracle. All John did was let it be known who Jesus is. Isn't that the easiest message to preach? Just tell who Jesus is. If I were to ask you who your parents are, it's not hard. Because you know your parents, or who your children are, it's not hard. So why is it hard for you to say who Jesus is? You should know Jesus too. And just say who Jesus is. That's the way I want us to see it. E.G. White in the book, Acts of the Apostles, page 9, one of my favorite quotations, she says, "The church is God's appointed agency for the salvation of men. It was organized for service, and its mission is to carry the gospel to the world." These days, there is this big thing over the last maybe 20, 30 years about mission statements. So now every organization has to have a mission statement and a vision statement. And if you don't have one, then something is wrong. But the church has always had a mission statement. The church has always had one. But in so many churches today, they want us to create a new one. That sounds fancy. It sounds as if we are with the time. But the mission of the church has always been there for us. Matthew 28. 19 and 20. It's there. It's there. But E.G. White continues. "It was organized for service, and its mission is to carry the gospel to the world. From the very beginning, it has been God's plan," that, listen carefully now, "that through his church shall be reflected to the world his fullness and his sufficiency." I'll say it again, listen carefully. "From the beginning, it has been God's plan," not my plan, but God's plan, "that through his church shall be reflected to the world his fullness and his sufficiency." It means simply this: when individuals see us, when they see us, they should see Christ. When they see us. And our task should be to carry out this mission. The Bible says in Matthew 24:14, "And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations. And then the end will come." There are so many persons who are dying for the end to come. We have been living in this messed up world and things are not getting any better. Our prayer has been, "Even so come, Lord Jesus." But I want us to, as we make that prayer, or as we make this our desire, that we purpose that we are ready. Because what sense it makes for Christ to come and we're not ready? Especially if you have spent 5, 10, 15, 20, 30, 40 years in this church. And after all of that, Christ comes and you're not ready. I won't forget reading on a worship card. I went to Western this college, now called Northern Cabin University. And I remember I lived on the dormitory, and I was a resident advisor on the floor. And I remember after worship one morning, as the resident advisors, there were four of us, were tabulating the cards that each student had to sign to indicate that they came to worship. Somebody wrote on a card, "I would rather see a sermon lived than hear one preach." And that thing has stuck with me. I have not forgotten it. And over the last few years, our general conference has this program they called Global Youth Day. And under the caption, "Be the Sermon," every year during March break, there is this program. The intent of this is to let people see your sermon outside of you preaching it the way I am preaching it. Let them see who you serve. Let them know who is your Lord. Let them see it. Because the reality is, we should be preaching every day. It should not be a once a day occurrence. Each of us can preach through our mannerisms. When you go somewhere and individuals look at you, they should see Christ. So we preach through our mannerism. We can preach through our conduct. We can preach through our deportment. We can preach through our speech, the choice of words. We can preach through our relationship to others. We can preach through the songs we sing. Are we singing the songs that Brother Paul sang earlier, Paul Cunningham sang earlier, or are we singing other kinds of songs? We can preach through the testimony of the goodness of God to us that we can make known to others. We can preach through the kindness that we demonstrate. So we all can preach. So we all should preach. St. Francis of Assisi. St. Francis of Assisi said, "Preach the gospel at all times, and when necessary, use words." I say it again. Preach the gospel at all times, and when necessary, use words. So I am making the point from this, that even if you can't speak well, you can preach the gospel. There's so many persons who would have been brought to the kingdom of God if individuals could see Jesus in us. The songwriter asks the question, can the world see Jesus in you? Do you live so close to the Lord today? Can the world see Jesus in you? Sometimes we have co-workers who we want to lead to Christ, or family members that we want to lead to Christ, and we spend all the time nagging them and pressuring them instead of just living that they can see Jesus. And every Sabbath morning we get up and it's a fuss because one is going to church and the other or others not going. But if you pray and live well, just this week, I can't recall who shared it with me, that they were working with somebody, or they were at this particular church right here in the GTA, and when the wife saw her husband getting dressed, she didn't know where he was going, but he was getting dressed. And at this time, the church was doing an evangelistic series. But she didn't know that he had interest. Because, you know, all she knows is that she has been nagging him. "When you come to church, and this way," and all of that she was doing. And lo and behold, a gentleman came to church. And lo and behold, when they called up those to get baptized, he walked up to the front. And he got baptized. Sometimes we need to pray some more and trust God some more. But we need to live well. Live. All we need to do is live the gospel. Live the gospel. When you're at school, let your classmates or your teachers see that you are different. They may ask you, why it is that you don't do so and so? Then you can speak. You go to your workers' functions and they see you avoiding certain things as in terms of your meal. They may say, why don't you have so and so? When there's a celebration and the champagne is brought in, you will take a pass. You should take a pass. Amen. I said, say amen. Because you can't drink it, you know, and then witness afterwards. So you can't drink it. But when you don't drink it, you can, they'll ask you why. If you're a female, like a certain age, they may say, are you pregnant? But if you're a male, they will ask you that question. Then you can explain why your body is a temple of God, etc., etc. The songwriter says, you are the only Jesus some will ever see. You are the only words of life some will ever read. So let them see in you the one in whose arms you'll ever need. Cause you are the only Jesus some will ever see. Acts, a powerful book in the Bible. Acts chapter 1. Verse 5 says, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. You will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. May I suggest, or may I make this statement, that we have some Seventh-day Adventists. Not talking about anybody here. I'm just speaking about Seventh-day Adventists. We have some Seventh-day Adventists who got the water baptism and remain comfortable with the water baptism. Not talking about anybody here. Thank you very much. But the water baptism alone is not sufficient. The water baptism alone is not sufficient. What the church needs in 2024 is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. When He, the Spirit of truth, comes, He will guide you into all truth. When He, the Holy Spirit, comes, He will prick the consciences of the persons to whom you share the gospel and will cause them to change their lives. When He, the Holy Spirit, comes. Because the Bible says in verse 8, same Acts chapter 1, but you shall receive power. Sometimes we are sharing God's word, but we have no power. We are powerless. We are weak. We are speaking, but we have no conviction. We are saying the thing, but we are timid. We are frightened. We are uncomfortable sharing about Jesus. But when the power of the Spirit of God comes upon believers, when you speak, they know you have been with Jesus. They know you have been with Jesus. But you know something? When Jesus said this, He said this near the time of His departure. And He said they must go and tarry for the Spirit to come. When they went to tarry, they tarried in the upper room. I have been in the upper room. The exact place where Jesus had, or the disciples met. But they didn't just go there. The Bible says they confessed their sins and they put aside their differences. Sometimes we are doing God's work and we know we are not together. But we are doing it just the same. And when we could have had success, when we could have had an A grade, we barely got a D plus. Why? Because we did not put away our differences. The second thing that they did, they, of course, meditated on Christ's holy life. They prayed as disciples together, they prayed. And the Bible says they were brought into one accord. They came together for the very first time. Even when they were with Jesus, they were not together. But now after his ascension and the Spirit took full possession of them, they came together. They were in one accord. And the Bible says, because they were together in one accord, the Spirit of God wrought mightily. Souls were won to the kingdom of God. We read that they spoke in tongues. These uneducated guys, these ordinary fishermen, began to speak in tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. The Spirit. You need to be filled with the Spirit to do God's work. And God is willing to fill all of us as long as we are willing. My question to you is, are you ready for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit? You know, our scripture reading, it said, as Joel chapter 2, starting at verse 28, says, "And it shall come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh." So none is excluded. None is excluded. The children are included. Sometimes we think our children shouldn't be involved. Take a page out of the Jehovah's Witnesses. They don't leave their children behind. There used to be a time when Seventh-day Adventists never left their children behind either. There used to be a time when Seventh-day Adventist children knew how to knock on doors and talk to people about Jesus. It used to be a normal thing. Those days are slipping by. If we are going to be effective, if we are saying, "I will go," it can't be just you alone will go. It must be that all of us are going. And if we are not getting our children on board now, by the time we are ready to get them on board, they are gone. And in some churches, they're talking about young people are leaving the church and pray for young people and all kind of things, but they weren't getting them involved when they should have gotten them involved. By the time they want to get them involved, it's too late. Their minds are already made up. They have already positioned themselves to leave the church, just waiting for the opportunity when they have a certain measure of independence. And that's the reason why when they go away to school, wherever they go, even to the Adventist institutions, we lose so many of them because they're waiting for the independence where they can make their own decisions. And their decisions are going to be, "I'm going to go away from church." So we can't leave the children out. We have to get them involved. They begin to realize this is their church too. They are stakeholders in the church. They have a responsibility in the church. And they can be filled with the Spirit in the church. When they are filled with the Spirit, we must not restrain them. we must allow them to function and be of service to Jesus Christ. Says, I'll pour it out on your young men, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions, your daughters and your sons shall prophesy, and your men servant and your maid servant. So all the important and the unimportant ones, they all factor there. Everybody's factored there. And God says he will do it. It's not the Malton Seventh Adventist Church doing it. It is God who is doing it. There are souls to be saved. Many souls to be saved in Canada. But even more so in these communities that relate to our congregation here. Souls to be saved. And there used to be a little quotation that my personal ministry's person used to read many, many years ago that says, God has no other hands but our hands. God wants to use us. God wants to use us. And there are people nearby us calling out, but we can't hear them because we're not listening. Calling out for help. But our eyes are fixed in a different direction. Some years ago, I read of a man named John Hawthorne. He was swimming some 30 feet off a beach in New Jersey, USA. Suddenly, people on the beach heard him crying out, "Which way to shore? Which way to shore?" An act of desperation, he reached out. By the time they, of course, realized he was in trouble, he had disappeared under the waves. When his body was recovered, his two sobbing sisters saw that it was their brother, and they explained his cry. They said he was blind. He had perished only 30 feet from safety while crying out, which way to safety, which way to shore. And there was no one to show him the way. May I suggest that there are many crying out, which way to Christ, which way to Christ, and nobody is hearing. Nobody is seen. Nobody is able to come to the rescue. We live in a country. It's not only multilingual, but it's multi-religious. And in this country, sometimes we think we shouldn't approach people because they might not be very responsive. But may I say to you, whenever that comes to your mind, do the very opposite. It's the devil who is discouraging you. There are so many persons out there who would be happy to have someone to pray for them. So many persons are going through challenging times. Not only in terms of course, their status, but some people ends can't meet financially. They're having problems with their family members. Problem at the workplace. With their neighbors. And if you can offer them some hope, they will be happy to entertain you. It's not for you to tell them, oh, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist and you need to come to church on Sabbath. That's not what I'm talking about. It's just for you to be there, to be a friend in times of need. When they are on their feet, they will remember that you prayed for them. There are ways in which we can get involved. There are ways in which we can do what God wants us to do. But when the Spirit of God is not in us, we don't know what to do. All we see are obstacles. But when the Spirit of God is within us, we don't see obstacles because we can turn those obstacles into stepping stones. Overwhelm me. Holy Spirit, bathe my trembling heart and brow. Fill me with thy hallowed presence. Come, oh come, and fill me now. I want us to believe, brothers and sisters, boys and girls, that God can fill us. And when God fills us, imagine what this church is going to be like. Imagine what this community is going to be like. When God fills us, imagine with me for a moment. When you walk into this church, the atmosphere is going to be different. The greeting is going to be different. The singing is going to be different. Everything is going to change because we are now functioning on a higher plane. And the Spirit of God fills us. All the closed doors becomes open doors. All those who slighted us will want to talk to us. All those who said negative things about us will begin to see positive things. Because they will see a different you than they saw the day before. I'm going to ask the praise team to come and sing for me. And as we sing this song, we are preparing ourselves for a great battle against the devil in this evangelistic series. Interestingly, Christ for the Crisis Gospel Crusade is my tagline for all my crusades for over at least 40 years. Christ for the Crisis. Christ will make a difference as we get into this evangelistic series. Sing for me, please. Bathe my trembling heart and brow. Fill me with thy hallowed presence. Come, oh come and fill me now. Everybody's singing now. Everybody's singing. Fill me now. Jesus, come and fill me now. Fill me with thy hallowed presence.
Fill me with thy hallowed presence.
Oh, come.
Oh, come.
May I ask you all to stand to your feet, please. As we sing the second, as the second stanza,
Thou canst fill me, gracious Spirit.
Oh, I cannot tell thee how.
I cannot tell thee how.
But I need thee.
But I
greatly need thee.
Greatly need thee.
Come, oh, come and fill me now. Everybody's singing now.
Fill me now.
Fill me now.
Fill me now.
Jesus, come.
Jesus, come.
And fill me now.
Fill me now.
Fill me with thy hallowed presence.
Fill me with thy hallowed presence.
Come, oh come.
Come, and fill me now.
Before we take the next stanza, I want to believe that as a church family, you would like to say, I, to give my all in this evangelistic series, I am willing to commit myself over to Christ and do the best I can in this evangelistic series. If that is your heart's desire, I'm going to ask you to leave where you are and come right here. I want to have a special word of prayer for you if you are committing to give your all in this evangelistic series. This may be the last series. We just don't know. But God wants to use you. God wants to use you to make a difference. God wants to use you to transform other lives. When the series shall have come to an end on the 27th of April, we must be able to say, we did our best. We did our best. It's about God. It's not about Pastor Sewell. It's not about Elder Thompson. It's not about Elder Common. It's not about any of the elders here. It's about God. Sing for me the third stanza, please. I am weakness full of weakness.
I am weakness full of weakness.
At thy sacred feet I bow.
At thy sacred feet I bow.
Bless divine eternal spirit.
Bless divine eternal
fill with love.
Spirit,
and fill me now. Everybody's singing now. Everybody's singing.
Fill me now.
Fill me now.
Fill me now.
Jesus, come and fill me now.
Jesus, come and fill me.
Fill me with thy hallowed presence.
Fill me with thy hallowed presence.
Oh, come and fill me now. About to pray, but I believe there might be somebody here who has not yet given his or her heart to Jesus, and today you would like to say, pray for me that I will give my heart to Christ Jesus. If you're here, let's raise that hand if you're here. God knows, God sees you, God sees your heart. God sees your heart. As we sing the next stanza, the last stanza. Cleanse and comfort. Keep those hands up as long as man is up. Keep yours up.
Cleanse and comfort.
Bless and save me.
Bless and save
bathe, oh bathe.
Me. Bathe, oh
my
bathe.
Heart and brow.
My heart and
as long
brow.
As man is up, keep your hand up too.
Thou art comforting.
And saving, hallelujah. Thou art sweetly filling now. Fill me now. Oh, fill me now. Jesus, come and fill me now. And fill me now. Fill me with thy hallowed presence. Come, oh come, and fill me now.
Oh come,
hallelujah.
And fill me now.
To God be praised. I saw those hands. I know it's getting a bit late, but lunch, there's no lunch today. It's prayer and fasting. So I'm going to ask, those persons who raise their hands, just be bold and brave enough just to come right here and meet me right here. Come, my brother. Come, my sister. Just come. I can want to shake your hand. And there's a child's hand behind somewhere. Just come along too. Just come right here as we sing the chorus one more time. And the Lord bless you, my brother. The Lord bless you. Come, my sister.
Fill me now.
Fill me now.
Jesus,
come and fill me now.
Jesus, come and
fill me with thy hallowed blessings, thy hallowed presence, thy hallowed spirit, thy hallowed saving grace. Come.
Oh, come.
Come
and fill me
Your eyes are closed, your heads are bowed, your thoughts are being lifted up towards heaven. Let us pray. Our Father, O God, we thank you for being here with us today in worship. We thank you for your mighty presence. We thank you, Lord, for knowing that we came into your house and you welcomed us and you blessed us and you drew us closer to you. We thank you. And we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for this upcoming evangelistic series. Just days away, we are putting before you, Lord, the speaker. Pray that you will take him here safely. You will be with him each time he stands to proclaim your truth, that sinners will know that there is still a Christ who saves. We pray for the team here at the Malton and the Bolton churches. You'll bless them as they work together for the saving of souls. We put before you, Lord, Pastor Sewell and his wife. As they lead out in this series, may Jesus Christ be seen in them. And may, as we pray for them, may souls be won to the kingdom of Christ. We pray for those who came forward, saying they are willing to commit their all. Oh, Father, make this a reality, I pray. Lord, some may have to turn down things to be here, to avoid situations to be here. Some may have to travel through the traffic to be here. But I pray, Father, that you'll always open a door, create a path. They can be here and function effectively. We pray for those who came forward, who are desirous of giving their lives to you. You know their situation, Lord. I don't know, but you know. And because you know and because you are God, you are able to work things out for them. They'll be able to serve you and give their lives to you. May nothing hinder them. May nothing, nothing hinder them. Pray for the wider church family. May together we pray for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. May together we pray for God to do only what God can do. And as we prepare ourselves for this evangelistic series, may if there are any divisions, any, Lord, petty issues, may you bury those. May you bring the church together as one. May you bind the church together with cords that cannot be broken, so that the name of Jesus Christ can be glorified. And sinners can find Jesus. Hear our prayer and answer our prayer, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. God bless you.
Pastor Swaby, thank you for that powerful and timely message. We are living in the last days, and we need to be ready for Jesus Christ's return. Will you take up the call today? Just a few announcements before I close. Prayer and fasting right after the service, and I do believe Dr. Swaby will be joining us. Is that correct, doctor? Oh, okay. That's what I heard. Okay. So, nevertheless, prayer and fasting. And I believe at 5 o'clock, Bible class at 5. Okay. And I believe after that, there will be a vesper by our very own Pastor Sewell. Let us close our eyes for prayer. Please stand, as a matter of fact. Dear Heavenly Father, we were reminded today that we are the only Jesus that some people will see. So help us, Father, to not take this lightly, that when we go into the world, people will see Jesus in us, and they will be drawn so that they can also be in a saving relationship with you. Empower us, Father, the things that we're lacking of. Put it in, instill it in us, Father, so we can go out and witness for you, to be powerful witnesses. Because we know whatever we do is not from you. It is you. It's not from us. It is from you, Father. Help us just to be ready and to be willing to go out, Father. And to also equip ourselves to study the Word of God and to be on our knees in constant communication with you. We know that your time is soon, Father, and we are to be purposeful in going out to minister to others. Father, I ask that you will be with the Malton Church family as we embark on our first evangelistic series. May everything be done to your glory and honor, and may only your name be praised. I pray that you will be with all the leaders, Pastor Sewell, all the elders, Father, the personal ministry leader, Father, and all the department leaders, Father. Help us to galvanize together so that we can come together in one accord to join hands together to go out to do your work. I pray for the community of Malton. May you bless them, Father. May you keep them and help them to realize that Jesus Christ is Lord and that they will make the necessary steps to give their lives over to you. Father, thank you for this Sabbath day, and I pray that you will be with us throughout the rest of the service for today. In Jesus' holy name, amen and amen.
Join us as we sing Precious Sabbath Day. Please remain standing.
Be thou blessed.
Be thou blessed on this precious Sabbath day. Be thou rest. Be thou blessed on this precious Sabbath day. God set apart a message just for you. So remember him in everything you do. Be thou rest, be thou blessed on this precious Sabbath day. Be thou rest, be thou blessed on this precious Sabbath day.
Seated and have a happy Sabbath.